seated. So glad to have one of our snowbirds back. Thank the Lord for that. Great to see her tonight. We're going to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12. If you'll turn with me there. Romans chapter 12. Romans is an amazing book of scripture written to Christians that were located in Rome, the very seat, if you will, of the Roman Empire, already in decline, by the way, but nonetheless the world's great superpower. And the Apostle Paul has a great theme of helping Christians in this book, dealing with salvation, evangelism, dedication to the Lord, yieldedness. It's in Romans where we see these really clear details, not only about becoming a Christian, but about how to bring someone else to Christ, about being able to live a surrendered life without guilt, without agony, without worrying about the past. It gives us a great picture of what's going on in the current culture. Because if you read toward the end of Romans 1, you'll find out that things are no different right now than they were then. It's basically the same. I love how the Apostle Paul weaves into Romans becoming a mature believer. And just like a journey, Romans does help us navigate with confidence and joy as we travel through this life. So let's pray and we'll talk about it. Father, thank you for our time together tonight. I pray that you'll bless our Bible study. Thank you for each one who's taken time out of their day to prioritize the Lord. And I pray that we will be used of you to be a blessing to them, near and far. I pray that you will help each one. Thank you for each one who is listening tonight. I pray that we will listen to the Holy Spirit most of all. In Jesus' name, amen. So let me begin with a story about my best friend, Dave. When I was a boy, one of my best friends through middle school, all the way through high school, was my buddy, Dave. We sat together at church. We played basketball together, soccer together, baseball together in school. We often sat in the same classes. We were very good friends. Dave probably spent a night a week at my house. My parents weren't too big on us kids going to other people's houses because of some of the mess they had seen growing up in their own families. And so most times kids would come over to our house, but that was okay because we had snowmobiles, motorcycles, tractors, and everything else everybody liked, cows. And all that, horses, whatever. So everybody liked to come to our house, and that was great. Dave would come over at least one night a week, and every summer, all summer long, Friday nights were camp out nights. I still take my grandkids back to the place where we used to camp out, and the little spruce trees that were 5 and 6 feet tall then are now 30 feet tall and real mature, and I don't know how that happened, But Dave and I were very close. And interestingly, Dave and I ran into the same kind of trouble once in a while that most of us did in our youth. And once in a while, we would get in trouble. And it wasn't anything that was what we would call a scarlet sin or anything like that. But we just do dumb stuff and we'd get in trouble for it. Now, most of you know what that's like in your youth. I'm not sure my wife did. She was an angel all growing up, so she was really good. But my dad confronted me after one of our misadventures, if I could use that term. And I tried to excuse my behavior. I was 2 years older than Dave. But I told my dad, I said, you know, Dad, it's not fair. Because Dave did it too. I remember my dad looking at me and saying, that is a bunch of baloney. And with that strong voice, Since when is it okay for you to do the wrong thing just because someone else does? And like looking into the eyes of John Wayne, I had to stare in those eyes. My dad did not mince words, and before his leather belt blistered my hind end, as a freshman in high school, my dad had one final comment to me. Look, I'm raising you, and we gave you to God to be a leader, not a follower. I had to sit on the bed and get cleaned up before I could go out. I thank God for my dad. I wish every kid had a dad that would discipline and love them and help them like that. Our dads can be those types of men. Don't have to be like my dad's personality. But I thank the Lord for him. Romans chapter 12. We have a wonderful piece of scripture here. I'll start with verse 1 because they're so tied together, but we're going to focus on verse 2. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. It's no big deal to love God and live for Him, not for a Christian. And then here's verse 2. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The instruction Paul gives in this passage is essentially the same as what my dad told me. Don't be a conformer. Be a transformer. A lot of difference. So we have a question based on the first slide, and I'm going to show it again. But here's the question. Are we temperature gauges or are we radiator thermostats? A lot of difference. I don't know a lot about cars, but I do know that the temperature gauge in a car is constantly changing based on the surroundings, especially on startup, because the vehicle goes from cold to its running temperature, which I think is about 192 degrees, if I'm not mistaken. Radiator fluid, the way it's built, can run peak at that type of temperature. Some of us remember running water in our cars in the summer and changing the radiator fluid every fall and putting in antifreeze for winter. I did that with the 1984 Caprice Classic. We were still doing that back then. Today, most of it's sealed systems. Nonetheless, that temperature gauge is constantly in flux. But the radiator thermostat, which is unseen, which is hidden inside the engine's, I'm going to call it the engine system of the car, where it works in conjunction with all of that. In the cooling system, it fights the overheating and it helps keep a steady temperature so the vehicle can operate at its maximum efficiency. Which draws me to a conclusion from my dad blistering my hind end with Dave. By the way, Dave got whipped too. My dad didn't care who it was. My friends and I were dumb. He took care of it. But then I look at cars and I think, this is what Christians are. We are either temperature gauges or we are radiator thermostats. J.B. Phillips is a commentator, and he made a statement once. J.B. Phillips said this statement, and I really like the statement. It's a great statement. He made this statement, and I love it, which I don't know why that's there, but it's okay. He said, I don't care what the world is doing. I'm not going to let it squeeze me into its mold. Let me say it again because I'm tongue-tied. I don't care what the world is doing. I'm not going to let it squeeze me into its mold. Ann and I had the privilege of growing up at two different churches that used to feature the evangelist Sketch Erickson. And at our church, he would come and he would bring an entourage of stuff with him to teach us about the dangers of rock and roll music, the dangers of television, and all this stuff. But he didn't just get up there and talk about it. And by the way, he had worked in Hollywood. He had the hair with the gray, with the silver stripes and the black stripes. The guy was like fancy pants, came in the church, brings all this expensive equipment, and then he plays this music from what kids were listening to, the top 10. He went through lyrics, and it was wild, man. This guy would do like a one-week revival with the church. And I remember choosing not to listen to a lot of that garbage because I had learned what was wrong with it. And I remember Sketch Erickson saying about Romans 12:2, especially in verse 1, don't let the world squeeze you into its mold. We are not called to be conformers to the world. We are called to be transformers for Jesus to our world. So look at your life this evening. Are you a thermometer? Because really, I think we've got about two types of believers. Are you constantly adjusting yourself to whatever goes around you? Are you literally conforming to everything? Or are you a thermostat? Are you changing the climate of the environment and the temperature of everyone with whom you come in contact to bring them after a better sort, a more godly sort? When you are with people and you have any influence with them, are you a thermometer or a thermostat? It's a very interesting question. And the reason I say it is because, you know, somebody on the internet said most Americans are sheeple. They're sheep and people. And if you've ever been acquainted with law enforcement training, military training, or training just to be tough, maybe a course in self-defense, if you act like a sheep, you will get eaten by wolves. Now, I know we're the Lord's sheep. But in the world in which we live, Jesus has called us to be wise as serpents. We don't mess with serpents. But we've also been called to be harmless as doves. And isn't it great to hear the doves now in the morning? They're becoming very open. It's a beautiful sound. I think we have to face some facts. And the fact is that you and I decide whether we are a thermometer or a thermostat. Thermometers, temperature gauges, they change, they adjust themselves. Whatever's going on around, I'll just be that. Unbeknownst to some Christians, this passage cries against that secular thinking. God did not call us to be thermometers. Jesus said, let your light so shine before men in Matthew 5 that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. And that's why the number one duty of a Christian is good works. We call those the spiritual disciplines, but it's not just ingestion. Now it's nutrition and exercise. You see the difference? Look, here's the issue. Advertisers pay millions of dollars each year to influence us. They influence what we wear. They influence what we eat. They influence where we eat. They influence the vehicles we drive. They influence where we're going to go on vacation. That's why people are sheeple. Because they just conform to whatever's around them. Well, I still remember the choices I made in my life to choose to be a leader, not a follower. Follower of Jesus, absolutely. And a follower of anyone who holds the Word of God as priority one and sticks with it, sure. But when it comes to the world around me, Lee Iacocca was right, and I can't use the whole quote, but you either lead, you follow, or you get out of the way. And the guy revived a car empire with that logic when he put Chrysler back on the map in the late 70s. And I'm aghast when I think that you could get a K car and now get an antique license plate for it, because I remember them being everywhere. I watch Columbo episodes and the cars seem normal. My kids watch the episodes and they say, oh, it's from like the 40s. It's amazing how fast time changes. Most people don't even know what kind of car Jim Rockford drove, and it was one of the coolest cars in the GM Pontiac market. You see, God's called us to be transformers, not conformists. Now, should we conform to His image? Absolutely, you know that. But you cannot serve two masters. No one can. We are either conforming to Christ and transforming our world, or we are conforming to our world and relatively making no difference for Christ. Jesus did not call us to live that way. He called us to serve Him. He called us to be transformed. Now, if you look at the passage here in Romans chapter 12, I'll just give you a simple lesson here. The Greek language is extremely clairvoyant with this. The Bible says, be ye transformed. Well, you can look at the Greek word, and it's really simple to know that we get our word metamorphosis from that word. Now, there are a few other words that it's a root to as well, but that's the simple understanding. This metamorphosis means to transfigure or to change. By the way, it's the same word used in Matthew 17 at the transfiguration. Remember, one of the most amazing parts of Jesus' life, when a few of the disciples got to see that, Matthew 17, 2, the Bible says that Jesus was transfigured before them, and His face did shine as the sun. Think about that. That's how bright it was. They could not look at Him. His raiment was white as the light. For a few brief moments, they got to see Him in His glory. And that's where His face shone like the sun. His clothes were white as the light. That's what this word is talking about. God has called us not to be impacted by the world. God has called us to make impact to our world. And I had to learn that lesson as a kid because of goofing off with Dave and getting in trouble. By the way, this same word is used in 2 Corinthians 3:18. But we all, with open face, the apostle says, you wouldn't think this, but we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass, as in a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory. It's that same Greek word, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. It's us who, with unveiled faces, because Paul is referencing the transfiguration, we reflect the Lord's glory. He emanated it, we reflect it. That's why we say Jesus is the light of the world, and it's right. But that's also why Jesus calls us the light of the world. He emanates it, we reflect it. We're being transformed into his likeness, changed, transformed from glory to glory. It's ever increasing glory. Our lives, as we grow in grace, begin to bring more and more glory to God as we grow as believers. That's why God called us not to be thermometers. He called us to be thermostats. An even temperature that people know. And that's what happens as we obey the Lord. We are transformed when we obey. Obeying without second-guessing God. Obeying without trying to find door number four. Option. And trying to decide that without our own thinking, we will launch out and just choose to live by faith. God has called us to stop this fluctuating all the time, living for an image, living for appearance, living for only what others will think of us, and start impacting our world. In other words, God has called us to start setting a climate zone. A steady faithfulness. To become like thermostats, maintaining a constant temperature, a constant climate. See, my dad was right when he blistered my hind end that day. And Dave's. My dad was right. I was goofing off, getting in trouble. I had to learn to be a thermostat that sets the pace, not a thermometer that adjusts to the conditions all around it. So tonight I just want to ask you, as you think about this, will you be a thermostat? Don't settle for just being a thermometer. If the Lord has saved you, the Lord has called you. You don't have to stand around and wait. I'm waiting for a management position with the Lord. You don't have to do that. God's not called anybody to management. God's called everybody to service. You don't have to sit around and saying, I'm waiting till the Lord calls me. He's already called you. You're bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So are you a leader? Are you a follower? Oh, I realize most people are not going to lead maybe like I am a leader. But every man is called to be a leader of his home. Every woman is called to help co-lead that home with that father and lead those children and do right. We get one opportunity. Let's do it right the first time. And just in case that doesn't happen, if God gives us the opportunity to do it the second time with grandkids, we're for sure going to do it right with them. Which do you prefer? I know which one comes most natural. Which one do you think Jesus intends for us to be? So how could you be different and choose to conform to his image instead of all theirs? What could God do in your life to make that transformation real just in one area? Has there been a circumstance lately that has caused you to wonder how you might be able to apply this? Because this I know. Some car maintenance is preventative, not just after breakdowns. And I've learned that common things happen to all of us. What would have changed if we had made the right choice? Thank God he gives us, usually in life, other opportunities to make the right choice. The good news of the Lord is he lets us over and over and over again enjoy his forgiveness when we confess. So my question tonight is real simple. Just really simple. Are you a thermostat? Working under where no one sees it, but helping set the temperature for maximum efficiency? Or are you just that temperature gauge? Both are not what we would call pricey parts, but one sure is more important than the other. They're both important. Let's be thermostats. Father, thank you for God's word. Thank you for the chance that we have to look just tonight at this simple verse in Romans, even just this word to be transformed. And I pray that you would help us to be transformed more into Jesus' image as we walk this earth. And we pray this in his name. Amen.
Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, vast unmeasured, boundless, free, rolling as a mighty ocean in its full. Spread his praise.